أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم since last couple of weeks we are discussing آيات about marriage, divorce and related matters and that is in fact in connection with the series which we started regarding zikr bi آيات الله And in that context, we are following, in fact, the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as in Surah 25, Ayat 73, that whenever you do the zikr of the ayat of your Rabb, then don't fall upon them blindly. So that is why we are trying to understand. We are just making an effort, a humble effort. Allah knows better. With this, today we have to come to the remaining part of the topic which we are discussing about talaq. And in this regard, I may just remind, just to recapitulate that last time we had seen that while discussing these ayat, the importance of these ayat, ayat numbers 8 to 11 of Surah 65 is, that here in this ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that the law about the family, which is the founding block of civilization, when that was tempered with and that law was violated, then generations, the civilizations were destroyed. And then they were taken to account and they were passed through a very severe account and they were put into great sentence of great punishment was passed upon them. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling in these ayat to be careful and be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here particularly the address is to those who believe and who are ulul albab, who are the critical thinkers, who think about the ayat of Quran, instructions of Quran, the injunctions of Quran, and then in that respect, the instructions of the Sunnah also. And in these ayat is a promise that if you follow this law, and this is one of those laws in which, for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that if you believe in this, if you believe in this manifesto, believe in this manifesto, and act accordingly good deeds, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they will take you out of the dark traditions, dark ages, dark shadows of that tribalism which was there. It will take you out of that and it will bring you to the enlightenment. This was the background. And then I had last time shown a couple of ayat and I requested to kindly look into those ayat critically. I am now taking up those ayat for discussion and I hope you have gone through those ayat. One was about the nushuz which has been mentioned in Surah 4, Surah An-Nisa, ayat 128. And that nushuz has been mentioned with reference to the man, that is husband. And then in another surah, in another ayat, same surah, Surah An-Nisa, ayat 34, again nushuz has been mentioned, where that nushuz has been mentioned with reference to the wife, the women. Now what is the difference in these two ayat? In this ayat, 128, when the reference has been made to the nushuz of the man, the husband, there it has been prescribed, the instructions are that there is no sin upon you, there is no guilt upon you if you reconcile, if you reform, if you mend your ways, which means that you mend your ways, make an adjustment, come to terms, reconcile. يصلح بينهما صلحا وصلح خير خير. Now this is the instruction in this ayat when it has been mentioned with reference to the husband. But in another ayat, that is 34, when mushuz has been mentioned with reference to women, there the procedure ultimately, if it fails, if a long process, if it ultimately fails, it may lead to the divorce. So what is the difference in these two things, two ayat? Nushuz is the same thing, whether it is for men or it is for women. There must be some difference. That is why there is a difference in these instructions in these two ayat. Now let us come back to the first ayat, that is 128. There you will see that this nushuz has been mentioned in as a synonym, according in along with eras, along with eras. Therefore, it seems that here the meaning of the nushuz is more in consonance with eras. That nushuz which is closer to eras, not necessarily something which is sinful, but it is still the same word, nushuz. But here it has been used in consonance, in synonymity with eras. Whereas we find that in another ayat where it has been mentioned with reference to the woman, it is not with reference to eras. It has been mentioned in contrast. There it was in synonymity with eras. Here it is in contrast with fasalihat kanitat hafizat, who are salih, who are fearful, who are conscious, who are protecting themselves against sin. In this context, it is referring to their integrity, not only the honesty, but it is referring to their whole personality, in whole integer, the integrity. And with that, in that contrast, nushuz has been mentioned, if it is in contrast to this integrity, which is in fact the part of any good woman or good man. It is with reference to that. Therefore, you will find that nushuz here has been translated differently, and there the nushuz has been translated differently. Otherwise, apparently, if one takes the meaning of nushuz only, it is totally contradictory and it is discriminatory. But when we analyze this ayat, there is no problem with Quran, problems with our own understanding, because we don't apply the critical mind. There's another important element which needs to be understood. That's then this will become more clear. This nushuz has been mentioned in ayat 128 with reference, and there the word balaha has been used. Bal is used for, yes, for her husband, but it is used for age, an aged person, sheikh, balaha. So maybe this nushuz and this era, because of this eras and age, the nushuz is being considered, is being conceived. There's a perception of nushuz, or whatever the reason, yet the word nushuz has been used. But these two words, balaha and araz, differentiate the meaning of nushuz in this ayat from the meaning of the word nushuz in ayat number 34, which I've also shown you there. But in this case, when you find that there is any araz, where there is any ignorance, somebody is avoiding, maybe because of age, the relationship has cooled off because of age, because of time, it has cooled off. There is nushuz in that. And there's a perception of nushuz. And when I have been dealing with these cases, that when I clearly observe that there is an element of balaha and there is an element of arazaha, and the perception of the woman is, misunderstanding of the woman is, or misunderstanding of the other party is, that they take it as if it is nushuz, because of nushuz. It may not necessarily be because of nushuz, but anyhow, whatever the situation, here in this ayat, it has been prescribed that it's better to reconcile. It is better to find a way out. And ultimately, there's one more important instruction which has been given here. Uhdiratil anfus shuhr. It is again referring to the nafs and the instigation of these nafs. Maybe this instigation of the nafs is for nushuz, and also it is because for the wrong perception which any partner carries. So this ayat has to be carefully analyzed along with the ayat 34. And whenever we, for example, go to Mufti and we ask him about the matter relating to talaq, he only wants to know, has he given three talaq? Yes, three talaq is over. But we don't take the whole perspective. In this ayat, that is 34, the nushuz has been mentioned in contrast, and then because of, in that perspective, if the nushuz is in the violation of being salha, if the nushuz is violation of being kanita, if nushuz is in violation of being hafiza, in that case, the instructions are different. But whenever we decide, we have to consider these two ayah together, whether for a man or for a woman. By qiyas, this ayat will also have a reference while considering any matter of fiqh about 128, and the 128 will have its reflection on ayat 34 whenever considering any fiqh or jurisprudence about ayat number 34. But we are not doing that. And I'm very sorry to say that you can make out as an exercise. And you go to a couple of muftis and ask them these questions. They are only concerned with three words, talaq, 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 and that's how usually it's happening. Now, in this ayah 34, which ultimately leads to the process of talaq, we come back now to the discussion of talaq, which we had started. There is a procedure. In this, before I take up this procedure, I invite attention to another ayat which I had pointed out last time also. We will not discuss it in detail today, but I am only referring to this ayat so that when we discuss talaq, this becomes clear to us. But this requires a separate discussion. In this ayat 228 of Surah Al-Baqarah, the ayat says, وَالْمُطَلِّقَاتْ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ. They have to hold back their anfus. They have to hold back themselves. From what? Here it's not mentioned from marrying only. It has a wider meaning. They have to hold back themselves, three periods. They have to hold back. Here, word iddat is not used. This is important to understand. And therefore, this holding back of nafs is not only for the purposes of iddat. It has a much wider perspective, much wider understanding. And then, here word iddat is not used. Where word iddat is used? This is important. That is why I want to show that how we are interpreting and where we are making a mistake. In another ayat that we are discussing in Surah 65, ayat 1 to 11. Now in ayat 1 to 3, there iddat has been mentioned. And we are applying it to that ayah 228. There, word iddat is not used. And in rabbas, The word has been used in a much wider context. Now look at these implications here. I'm not giving a fatwa, but kindly, I'm inviting your attention to kindly consider and reconsider this ayat of Quran, how we are implementing this in our jurisprudence. Ya ayyuhan nabi, iza talaqtumun nisa, when you divorce your women, your wives, fatallaquhunna, then complete the process of your talaq, give them talaq, li, for, in, within, iddatihinna, their given time, complete your talaq, talaquhunna, li iddatihinna, within their given time. If the given time in the case of divorce is 3 periods, you have to complete it within 3 periods. If you have a firm view about it, or if it is whatever the time of the iddat, because it is different, we'll come to that. It may be 3 periods, it may be 4 months, 10 days, or whatever the time, then you have to complete it. And address is to the man. And the address starts from the Prophet, peace be upon him, himself. And it is to the male, fatallaku hunna. When you go for talaq, then give talaq, complete it within the given time, iddatihinna, their given time, not your given time, time which is given to them. Wa usu, word hisab has not been mentioned. Usu. Now it's not only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The difference is that here you count on the critical path till its completion. You kindly see the dictionaries. You count till the end, the last day, last minute, critically, on the critical path, so that you achieve the last objective, you achieve the objective till the last. In modern terms, we can say you manage it on the critical path management system. Usul iddat, here kindly, very humbly I am requesting to note that the order is to the man, plural, give talaq within the given time, and here you count it on the critical path, and you count it this iddat, you observe this iddat. Observing not in the sense as the woman has to observe, but observing in the sense of completing the process. It is iddat here, order applicable to the man to complete it within the given time, and it is equally applicable to the man also, because the address is to the man. Mukhatib in jurisprudence matters to whom the address is being made. Here the address is to the man. Kindly don't go by my interpretation. Look at usul iddat. You count it on the critical path method, critical path to achieve the objective. Now, if the man is allowed to remarry some other woman the next day, and woman is kept waiting for 40 days or for 4 months and 10 days or whatever the time of the iddat, but the talaq says, at-talaq maratan, she can come back. There can be reconciliation within this entire period of reconciliation of talaq. If the man is allowed to marry the next day, then how can she come back? It means we are circumventing the law in fiqh. We are circumventing it. We are stopping it. We are circumventing the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that she should not come back. There should be no reconciliation, whereas the ayat is asking for reconciliation. Therefore, my very humble interpretation is, my humble opinion is, you read this ayat and read these words, that it applies to the man also, that out of respect for the woman, for the wife, respect for the family which we have been joined with, and respect for the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the man should not make haste that on one side, on the day he says talaq, 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 next day or the same day he marries another woman. This is total disrespect to the human relationship, human rights, and disrespect even to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which this ayat says, also let the, you man, observe the iddat, wait till the process is complete. Don't block the way to reconcile, to reconciliation. Ayat is before you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ رَبَّكُمْ. Be fearful of God. Be conscious of God. And look at this. This is further reinforced. This opinion is further reinforced. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the same ayat, لَا تُخْرِجُونَهُمْ. Don't expel them. Don't throw them out. Don't kick them out of the house. لَا تُخْرِجُونَهُنَّ مِنْ بُيُوتِهُنَّ. In the houses where they are housed, in their homes, don't expel them. If she's not expelled, she is not to be expelled, and she has to be there for iddat, then what the human respect, self-respect, human dignity demands? Does it demand that while the woman in iddat is in the house, in the same house, the husband is marrying another woman? How can we interpret it? He has to observe the iddat along with the woman. Wait for the sake of God. Lillahi, wattakullah. Be respectful to the human relationship. Be respectful to the law of God. Don't be so lustful to violate it for 40 days. Wala yakhrajna. And they should also not leave. I leave it to you. Kindly consider this ayat. What have we been doing? What are we doing with the fiqh? How we are interpreting it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to create a civilized society. A civil society. A civilized society. Moderate civil society. Ummatan wasta, not on the extreme to go for the lust or go for any extreme. Go to any extreme. A balanced one. Balance in relationships. Have respect for each other. If she has to observe, as a human respect, wait for the same period, at least. So that even if she should not know that you have been expelled out and then the next day you are married. وَتِلْكَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning that these are my hudud. Had is not only this, adultery. The had is here. For human relationships, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used the words وَتِلْكَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that those who violate these hudud, they are doing zulm. And zulm, and then violating the amr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I leave this discussion here. I come back to the topic of talaq, which we were discussing, and we will discuss that. In another ayat also, there is a reference to iddat. But here again, this aspect of iddat, which has been mentioned along with the maintenance, and that maintenance is, we will discuss separately, but I'm just pointing out that in the meantime, you go through this ayat. It's not just the maintenance during the period of iddat. It is a maintenance till she is remarried or till her death. And in such a manner that in the same situation, in the same condition, with the same standards in which you are living, and make them comfortable. Give them a comfortable life even after divorce and iddat. This ayat 33:49, we will discuss again when we discuss maintenance. But here in advance, I'm just pointing out that look at these words. Now, why the iddat has to be, why the talaq has to be completed during the period which is given for iddat? Look at this decision. I quoted it from Israel, but it is happening in the Muslim world, everywhere. How long the talaq takes, when you go to the courts, 30 years, 20 years, 10 years, even if it takes 1 year, that is beyond iddat. We are violating it. If we are not doing it, iddat hinna. In Israel, this is a court decision. In Tel Aviv, this is a decision. They jailed a man for 30 days. Although it's not a commensurate punishment, very small punishment, but they had been punished for helping his son to refuse to give her daughter-in-law a divorce for 11 years. 11 years, he didn't complete the process of divorce. You go to the courts, kindly take up a study in any Muslim country, in any court, family court, and see what is the average period of the case in which the case of divorce is decided. Every person who is guilty of this, in this case, if I think, I don't know the details of the case, I don't know, I'm not giving a general judgment, but simply looking at, superficially looking at it, if the divorce are delayed for 11 years, he should have been punished for 11 years, if not 11 years, at least 11 months. There should have been compensation, financial compensation for the woman for 30 years. She lost, maybe she lost her youth. She could not have children during that period. She could not have, we don't know how she was living, what was the financial position. She should have been compensated, that she is not compensated. These are important points for those who understand. These are the important points for those who wattakullah, for those who are conscious of God, for those who are ulul albab, for those who believe that the Quran has come to create an ummatan wusta. It has come to create a civilized society, not the brutal society. That here, say talaq, 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 she goes, she observes iddat, she's thrown out, and the next day the man is marrying, it is happening. And then we come back to discuss this process of talaq, which we were discussing. Now, this will, I think, help us to understand different aspects of talaq. I'm leaving these ayat here. These will be discussed again, because when the time comes for their discussion. These ayat, all these ayat I'm leaving for the discussion later on. How they have to be given the maintenance. Now, At-Talaq Maratan. Surah Al-Baqarah, ayat number 229 says that talaq is twice. Last time we had discussed that one talaq is a process. Process which has conditions, which has procedure, which has validity, which has effectivity, and during that period, iddat hinna, entire process of talaq has to be completed if one is so adamant to give talaq, and then the matters related to the consequences of talaq have also to be decided, because once she is thrown out, she should not be made to beg and run about to get her rights or to get the rights for her children. One talaq is completed up to iddat in through this process, not talaq, 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 through this process. This is sunnah. This is Quran. We have seen that ayah 34-35. Now, at-talaq maratan, it's twice. I think before that, I may expose ayat number 34. That will, I think, show that why it is important to go through the process, because process is not given by the man. It is not given by any human being. It is given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ayat number 34. If you kindly open ayat number 34, you will see that there the process is given, the procedure is given, that if you fear that there is nushuz, then in that case, this violation of being kanitat, salihat, hafizat, then in that case only, it's not that You are angry because of food. You are angry because of anything else. The starting point is nushuz. If you are fearful, you are afraid that there is nushuz, then what should one do? Fa'izuhunna. Make waz to them. Wahjuruhunna. Then you can put some, increase some psychological pressure. You leave the room. You cannot expel her from her room. Look at this ayat. Ayat is before you. If you think that she is not accepting your advice, she is not listening to you, she is not agreeing to that, she is not ready to give nushuz, in that case, you leave the room. Ayat is before you. She cannot be expelled. And then, after that, even if it is not, even after that it is not resolved, then Vadribu Hun Zarab. This has been translated as beating her. What is the, is that the only meaning of word Zarab? When Ashab al-Kahf, they are going to the cave. There Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Zarabna Allah Azanim. I put a zarab on their ears. Was it a physical zarab? Were they beaten up? Zarab does not always has the same word, the meaning of beating. When the instructions came that the piece of cloth, your head is scarf, you pull it down and wrap it around your chest as hijab, their word zarab has been used. Does that mean that with piece of cloth which you are wearing on your head, pull it up and then you beat your chest with that? Zarab does not have the only meaning that is beating. It has different meanings. Maulana Asad, the translator of Quran, the Mufassir, Asad, Muhammad Asad, he says, in the interpretation, that zarab means, and it has been used in Quran at different places, to give an example, make an example, give an example. In the court you say, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm making this example for you. Zarab, word zarab has been used. Making an example in law, precedent, to increase the pressure. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that you then increase the pressure upon them. وَزَرَبُوا هُنَّ. And then if she is beaten up, then what is the point in making a committee, arbitration committee, calling her parents, calling your parents? In the next ayah, that is 35, it leads to the formation of committee. You increase the pressure on her. And one of the pressures could be that now you constitute a committee. It was between you only to now bring it out before the Ahl. And then let that arbitration committee decide it, recommend it, reconcile it, make a reconciliation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making promise in these ayat that if you reconcile, it's not only that I'll reward you in the hereafter, I'll reward you in your family also, and I'll reward you with more risk. There's an incentive that if you reconcile, I'll give you more risk. Now, I come back to this ayat which we were discussing, At-talaq maratan. That at-talaq is twice. Talaq is twice. In this way, when this has been completed, and talaq has come to the point where it is complete, then this process, once completed, she can come back. Then next time, same thing happening, there is separation, same way, same process, talaq has taken place, now an iddat has completed, then that will constitute at-talaq maratan, two talaq. You can look into the fatwa of many people, but Zakir Naik's fatwa may be easily available on net also. You can see that also. Here also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is leaving a room that when two talaq in this way, two processes of talaq in this way have taken place, even then you can take back, you can reconcile, you can come back. And in the same way, if third time, same thing happens, separation is there, then after the iddat, then it's fine. She can't come back. You can't make rujoo. It's only for a talaq maratan, twice. Third time, one cannot marry. Unless she goes and marries somebody else in the natural way, in the natural process. And from there, in the natural process, she is divorced. And she comes back. Then only you can reconcile, one can remarry. Otherwise, third time, without intervention, no. But there is no provision of halala. It is haram. It is prohibited. It is expressly prohibited. It is punishable. It is abhorrible. It is sinful. But still, even the mullahs are advising this. There's no such provision in Quran and Sunnah. At this point, when I say that after third talaq, she cannot come back, there cannot be remarriage between the same two persons. Look at these two ayat. If we look at them, apparently, one finds some difficulty in understanding. Same words are used here in these two ayat. In the same ayat, ayat number 230 of Surah Al-Baqarah, it says, فَإِن تَلَّكَهَا, in the next sentence also in the part of the ayat, فَإِن تَلَّكَهَا, same words, that if you give them talaq, if you give them talaq, in the first sentence it says, if فَإِن تَلَّكَهَا, if you give them talaq, then she is not halal for you, she is not person permissible for you, unless she gets hatta tankiha zawjan ghayrahu, unless she marries another person, has a nikah with another person. But in the next sentence it says, fa'in talakaha, if you give her talaq, then it's not sinful for you if you ruju. Apparently, what is the difference in these two? Same words, fa'in talakaha fala, fa'in talakaha fala. In one sentence it says fala tahil, it's not halal for you, and but in the next sentence says it's not sinful for you. What is the catch here? That's why I say that we have to understand the ayat critically. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. You have to understand the Quran not only in one word or in one ayat or within one ayat, but in its entirety of its usage, its nuance, its context, and its construction. Here, in the first part, it says, Mimbadu. When the talaq is complete, after that, when the process is complete, because talaq is not saying talaq, talaq, talaq. It is not talaq. It is Mimbadu, when you have completed li'iddat hinna. When you have completed the talaq process, baad, their word baad has been used. And in the next sentence, word baad is not there. It says that during the process of talaq, while the process is going on, you can make a rujoo. This is the critical understanding that how the talaq has to be dealt with. But once talaq maratan have taken place, then there is no rujoo. And after that, when three talaq processes have been passed and three iddats have been completed, after that there is no rujoo, unless there is mimbad, after that she goes hatta tankih zawjan ghayrahu, unless she goes and marries there. And these are also part of hudud Allah, wa tilka hudud Allah. Yukima hudud Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning again and again that these are my hudud. Be careful. Be fearful. what is yataraja word ya raja was used here. You have to, when you make ruju, it's not one-sided. You cannot force. It is dual. It is reciprocal. Form 6 has been used. Form 6 is reciprocal. When both of you make ruju, it's not one-sided. There are cases where people give talaq. And after that, they think that they have done something wrong. And they are not allowing her to go out. Now she does not want to stay there. But it is by consent. It is equal. There are equal partners. The important point is, I had mentioned last time also, the important point in the matters of talaq is that since there are two partners, if they agree to talaq, even once it is talaq, they agree, they separate, they complete the process, they complete the iddat. But if one of them is not agreeing, they come to the court, go to the qazi, then all these things have to be considered, all these processes, all this law comes into force, comes into effect, comes for enforcement. I think I stop here. I have completely taken 45 minutes, and next time we'll continue with the remaining part of iddat, remaining part of the ayat which I left there, and then we start to go with the talaq matters also. I'm breaking this discussion on talaq at different points because I want to break the monotony. Otherwise, we'll be discussing talaq for weeks together. So I'm breaking it in parts. Thank you very much. Subhan rabbika rabbil izzat amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت، وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت، فإنك يا ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فاتبعونا أحسنه. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك، وبطاعتك عن معصيتك، وفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك أعلى كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. Oh Allah, some of us had their parents have passed away, and they have friends and relatives who have passed away. Oh Allah, grant them your mercy, make their graves garden from heaven, and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, remedy our sit. Oh Allah, remedy our son Ma'raj and the brother and his mother, and grant them full and speedy recovery. Oh Allah, you alone is the ultimate curer. There is no cures but yours. Oh Allah, grant them a cure that leaves nothing of injury or ailment. Oh Allah, guide our children, protect them, and make them righteous. Oh Allah, we ask you with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.